In our very first algebra class, we learned about the zero product property, which states that if a product of two numbers is equal to zero, then at least one of the number has to be zero. This is very useful when solving equations that can be factored. However, in many number systems, the zero product property fails. And one such number system is called the integers mod 12, which we can roughly think of it as doing arithmetic on a clock. And any multiple of 12, we can treat it like 0. And in this number system, we can treat 13 like it is 1, and we can treat negative 3 like it is 9. In this number system, the zero product property fails as there are many different pairs of numbers that multiply to 0. In this episode, we will take a deeper dive into ring theory and determine the criterion for nicely behaved rings as opposed to pathological rings, which break the zero product property. Last time, we said that a ring is a set on which we can add, subtract, and multiply any two elements. But how about division? There are rings that play really nicely with division, and division ring is a ring where every element except for 0 has a multiplicative inverse, and a field is a commutative division ring. And over these really nice rings, just like how we define A minus B to be A plus the additive inverse of B, we can define A divided by B to be A times the multiplicative inverse of B. For example, over the field of rational numbers, division is just taking product with the reciprocal of the second number. And over the field of rational functions over the reals, we can easily divide using the same method. And in many rings that are not even a division ring, like the matrix ring, most matrices are invertible, so we can do that for most elements of the ring. But how about the integers? This ring only has two invertible elements, which are 1 and negative 1. So using the previous notion of division as an operation, we can only divide by 1 or negative 1. But we know very well that 6 divided by 2 is 3, even without requiring 1 half in your ring. And over the polynomials over integers, we know that x squared minus 4 divided by x minus 2 is equal to x plus 2 without requiring rational functions. We can think about division not as an operation, but as a divisibility rule, meaning 6 divided by 2 is equal to 3 because 2 times 3 is equal to 6. And this is more like how we think about division in elementary school before we learn about the fraction. And we can extend that idea to work for any ring in general. Let D and M be any two elements in a ring. If we can find A in the ring such that M is equal to D times A, then we say D is the left divisor of M, and M is the right multiple of D. One easy mnemonic that I like to use is that D is on the left side, and need to multiply something on the right side to get M. Using similar idea, we can define the right divisor and the left multiple as well. In a non-commutative ring, it is possible for an element to be only one-sided divisor of another. For example, this red matrix is a right divisor of the green matrix. However, the same red matrix is not a left divisor of the green matrix. Over any commutative rings where the distinction is not necessary, we can just say divisor and multiple without requiring direction. And we use the vertical bar to denote that the first element divides the second. Or in the more familiar passive voice, 6 is divisible by 2. Since every ring has two very special elements, the additive and the multiplicative identity, they give rise to very important divisibility properties in the ring, so we will give them some special names. If an element A is both a left and right divisor of 1, such that A's respective right and left multiplicand is both equal to B, then we say A is a unit of the ring, and B is the multiplicative inverse of A. To give a familiar example, all the invertible matrices in the matrix ring are all units. This is the typical textbook definition of what a unit is, and it does feel a little restrictive on what the other divisor can be. And I want to ask, is it possible for A to be both left and right divisor, such that the other divisor is different? Over commutative rings, B has to obviously equal to C. But can B and C be different in any other ring?
Well, using associativity, B and C have to equal each other.
And just defining a unit to be an element that is both the left and right divisor of 1 would be enough.
And from this, we can see that some standard definition in mathematics can be a little bit overcooked, like a well-done steak.
Next, we will look at divisors of 0. Well, obviously, every element of the ring are divisors of 0, since anything times 0 is equal to 0. So we have to come up with something more interesting. We say, if A is a left divisor of 0, such that B is not equal to 0, then we say A is a left 0 divisor. And we can come up with a similar definition for the right 0 divisor. To provide an example, the red matrix is a left 0 divisor, since you can find the non-zero blue matrix that right multiply to 0. And this red matrix is a right 0 divisor as well. In fact, every singular matrix in the matrix ring are both-sided 0 divisors. Now, is 0 a left 0 divisor? Well, from this definition, it is, since 0 times a non-zero is equal to 0. But I will be using the convention to exclude 0 from being a 0 divisor. And I have seen both conventions to include and exclude 0 from being a 0 divisor used by different mathematicians. Now, I have two very important questions. Is it possible for an element to be only one-sided divisor of 1? And is it possible for an element to be only one-sided 0 divisor? From rings we have seen so far, it doesn't seem to be possible, but answers to both questions is yes and yes. But the example ring that I need to construct just to provide examples are fairly involved, and I think it should be covered on a separate video. In some sense, that is a good news, since most rings that we will deal with, if an element divides 1 from one side, then it is necessarily a unit, and if it is a 0 divisor from either side, then it is a both-sided 0 divisor. So now, we can classify ring elements with respect to how nicely it behaves under multiplication and division. On the left side is the set of all units, which in short are elements that behave really nicely with multiplication and division since they are all invertible. And on the right side, we have 0 divisors, which are the bad boys that break all the rules, such as the 0 product property. On the left side, I will place 1 in the center as the king of all units. And on the right side, I will place 0 in the center, but as a dethroned king in its special category, since some mathematicians said they don't like calling 0 a 0 divisor. And then there are ones who are neither. Let's take a look at some example rings. The set of all real numbers is a field. So every element except for 0 is a unit. Then how about the integers? This ring has 2 units, which are 1 and negative 1, and it has no 0 divisors. So most elements, like 2 and 3, are in the neither category. Division in the integer ring is not as nice as the reals or any other field, since you can't just divide any 2 elements. But it is nice enough that there are none that breaks the rule significantly. In fact, middle class being the vast majority is what makes it particularly interesting number theoretically, since we can't divide any 2 pairs of numbers like 7 divided by 5, but we can talk about remainders and prime factorizations and such. Then we have the matrix ring, which is very polarized with no middle class, like the late stage capitalism. Then how about the integers mod 12? Any number that shares a factor with 12 is a 0 divisor in this ring. And ones that do not share a factor with 12, or we say relatively prime to 12, are units in this ring. For example, 5 is a unit, since 5 times 5 is equal to 25, which is equivalent to 1 in this ring. And this ring does not have a middle ground either. 12 is a highly composite number, so Z mod 12 happens to have a lot of 0 divisors. But what if we instead take the integers mod a prime? Then it automatically is a field. Out of all the rings on this list, the integers is a bit special since the most elements in the ring are in the neither category. Do we know any other ring like this? How about the polynomial ring over the rational numbers? In this ring, the only invertible elements are the constant polynomials except for the zero polynomial. And most elements are in the neither category.
And just like the integers, the string has more interesting divisibility. And we spend many hours learning about factorization and long division and all sorts of different algebraic properties of polynomials in pre-calculus. I want to introduce two more rings that are very similar, but one is a field while the other has zero divisors. The complex numbers is a two-dimensional extension of the real numbers, with imaginary unit I being square root of negative 1. Every element except for 0 in this ring is invertible, so this ring is a field. There is a slight variant of this two-dimensional number system called the split complex numbers. And the main difference is that the imaginary unit j squared is equal to 1 instead of negative 1. And this number system can be very useful when describing the geometry of the flat spacetime in the special theory of relativity. Unlike the complex numbers, there are non-zero elements that cannot be inverted, namely elements that have the same absolute value for a and b, such as 3 plus 3j or 5 minus 5j. And they are the zero divisors of the ring. So in the rings that we have seen so far, elements could be separated into units, zero divisor slash zero, or neither. But is it ever possible for an element to be a unit and a zero divisor at the same time? Maybe in some really weird ring, that is possible, right? Well, the answer is no, and here is the reason why. Suppose by contradiction that A is both a unit and a left zero divisor. Then A has A inverse in the ring, and there also exists B such that A times B is equal to 0 while B is not equal to 0. Then B is equal to 1 times B, and 1 is equal to A inverse times A, and A times B is equal to 0, so this entire thing equals 0. Which is a contradiction since we assume that B cannot be 0 in the first place. So our supposition that A can be both a unit and a left zero divisor at the same time must be false. And similarly, we can prove that A cannot be a unit and a right divisor at the same time either. So our original assumption that units and zero divisors were separate categories was correct. Now, let's rank elements based on how nicely they behave with respect to left divisibility. This time, neither category may contain right zero divisors that are not left zero divisors. If B is equal to C, then obviously A times B is equal to A times C. But what about the converse? If A is equal to 0, it is false. And if A is equal to a left zero divisor, then it is false as well. And if A is a unit, then it is obviously true since we can multiply by A inverse on the left side to cancel A out. So the category that we are most interested in is the neither. So let's start by assuming that A is neither a zero nor a left zero divisor. Then we can subtract AC on both sides and use the distributive property to factor A out. And since A is not a left zero divisor, the zero product property must hold. And since A is not equal to 0, it must be the case that B minus C is equal to 0. So this proves that B is equal to C as long as A is neither 0 nor a left 0 divisor. So we give a special name to elements that are neither 0 nor a left 0 divisor, and that is left cancellable, or some mathematicians call it left regular. And similarly, we call elements that are neither 0 nor a right 0 divisor a right regular or right cancellable. In short, it is the zero divisors in the ring that make the multiplication and the division really funky. And if we don't have them, then every element in the ring becomes cancellable. So just like how we define division ring, which are rings where every element except for zero is a unit, and the field, which is a commutative division ring, we can define a ring where every element is left and right cancellable. And we call it a domain. And it has nothing to do with domain of a function. But these poor ring theorists probably ran out of cool words to use. And we say a commutative domain is an integral domain. And this has nothing to do with this integral. And it's named after the integers since it is a commutative ring on which every element is cancelable. As cool as rings with zero divisors are, they are cool because they are bad. And we all have phases where we are attracted to bad boys and bad girls. And we will be over that phase soon enough. And many videos in the series will be dedicated specifically to the theories of various kinds of integral domains. I will be using a funny notation here, but it will be explained in detail in the next video. The integers mod 12 is a ring, which is like the integers, but every 12 is treated like 0. And we can think of it as a number line that wraps around in a circle every 12. Then how about the polynomials over the real numbers, such that x squared plus 1 is treated like 0? This ring is really the same ring as the complex numbers, and x obeys all the same rules I would in the complex numbers. And similarly, we can come up with the description for the split complex numbers. In the next couple of videos, I will go into full detail as to what it means for two rings to be essentially the same ring, and explain this wrapping around in a circle business in detail.